Several critics have mentioned that the portrait in the back of the portrait has a strong Bacon influence. Is that intentional, or what were you trying to do here?
Yeah, no, I totally understand what that theory. I would say that there is some inspiration from Francis Bacon. You know, his art is very tortured, and there's a lot of expressive movement and brushstrokes in his work. And I think that relates in this painting. It is a portrait of Mr. Total's mother. And that was a very turbulent relationship. And a lot of the subjects in Francis Bacon's work stems from his turbulent relationship. So I think it's a reflection of that. But yes, I can definitely see where that opinion comes from.
Now, is this a portrait of somebody living or somebody that is famous from history?
This is a current living person, although some say he's in between.
In between living and not living?
Yes. We don't really know where he is.
Is he in a library, or is
this is the library of his own home.
Oh, I see.
He has a very extensive library.
I can believe it.
He is an academic. He's a scholar.
I recognize some of those books.
Yes.
I think I gave him some of those books.
I'm sure. It's a very impressive collection.
Yes.
Works of art in their own right.
And the foppish attire, where does that come from?
Well, he's Ilyich.
I see.
Yes, and again, a scholar, professor. A lover of velvet.
A velvet.
Tweed.
Velvet, tweed.
Patch, elbows, corduroy trousers.
Right.
Moth-eaten wool cardigans.
Right.
Well-dressed, but not well-kept.
Unkempt.
Yes, unkempt. Much like his eyebrows, which lend a lot of expression to his character.
Actually, I don't think I can see any eyebrows in this portrait, but there they are.
There they are.
Yeah.
I think they...
My goodness, it almost looks like a prehistoric turtle when you look at those eyebrows.
Yes, he demands attention.
Actually, it looks more like a dinosaur than a turtle, I think. Did you do this study from an anatomical design or from nature?
This was both from a portrait of a turtle and morphing in with, it was an amalgamation of a turtle and a person. Because
it is
a representation of their spirit.
It truly is in between, isn't it?
Yeah.
But, I think I see the beginnings of a shell. Yes, I hadn't seen that before.
Mm-hmm.
How clever of you.
Oh, thank you. Yes, no, it was very
I thought it was just a humpback before, but it's actually a shell.
Yes, covered
clever.
In his
How clever.
His jacket.
Uh-huh.
But yes, can't be a turtle without your shell.
I see, yeah, he disguised well. Disguised well beneath the velvet.
Yes, beneath the velvet.
What do you plan to do for your... What are you currently doing?
Currently, I am working on some expressive still life portraits.
Still lives?
Yes. More geared towards the human form than that of the tortoise. So I wouldn't say that I wouldn't go back to painting Mr. Turtle, but yeah.
Well,
once
you've captured the turtle, you may move on. You may never be able to match this turtleness.
It was an enjoyable process, but perhaps one in a lifetime.
Thank you, Autumn. Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
even from this great distance. My memory of Singapore is sharp. It started at a manor house set off the main street. It was a high-class whorehouse, and this young Chinese student just wanted to talk philosophy, and we talked about the I Ching, and she was eating wonton soup, and so I paid for another hour, but then these goons came in and threw me out the window into the oleander bushes, which saved my skull. Wandered down to the thieves' market, and things got very, very thin. I picked up a few pieces from a thief, presenting his wares on a small box. Come back tomorrow. But then I had a hotel room full of antiques, beautiful antiques, so I had no way to pay the bill. I went out to the racetrack and won 55-1 on Triptrix in the first race, and one after that, and one after that. And I was so happy to get out of Singapore. My bags at the airport. On the airplane, I had that old recurring dream again. My father.
May I have your attention, please? The plane will be landing shortly. We have been diverted to Copenhagen, Denmark. All of you will be placed on a new flight to London as soon as possible. We are sorry for the inconvenience. Please fasten your seat belt. We will soon be on the ground.
Threat diverts the plane to Copenhagen. Frank's standing on the aluminum stairs, freezing 20 below, waiting for the Danish cartoon bus in horizontal driving sleet, holding two large Adidas bags close to body heat, when he hears something crack.
You don't know Texas, Ed. He's a very old friend of mine. You don't really want to know. Well, I don't know. I don't know if I can trust him. According to him, it's all going to be over very soon. Everybody. The whole thing.
Okay. Are you just being a little dramatic?
I know. Me talking to you now makes me feel like... It makes me feel like it's not true, but I know actually that he knows a lot, and it could well be true. The thing is, I don't know what to tell you. What do you say?
Well, you need to give me more information. What do you mean?
Well,
everything's
actually,
going to shit anyways.
No, not just...
is there a meteor coming to Earth?
There are things you don't know, and I can't get into it, this. But his solution was to go. And again, to go in a way that you don't even know. You don't even know. There is all these things that you don't know about. I'm fidgeting because what does it matter when I'm doing this? Nothing. This doesn't matter anymore. And yet I'm doing it because I just don't know what to do.
Okay, Mom, can you look at me for a second? What's going on? You're scaring me a little. You seem a little frantic, a little crazy, honestly.
I'm sorry.
No, it's fine. I can't help you if you don't tell me what's going on. You're being very cryptic in a really bizarre way.
There is a whole world in my life that you don't know.
Can you share with me?
The opium business has always been good for us. It's always been a steady flow of cash. But, alas, there are bigger fish to fry. I'm Carlos now.
When everything degenerates and the turtles come back, it'll be fun. It's true. Or little ones run into sea. And millions of baby turtles pop up on the beaches.
They run into sea in mass. How many killed, but survive.
Yeah. So what do you see going forward, John?
I see further of turtles going up and down. I see the art project collapse.
Art project collapse?
Not Texas Red.
Well, of course Texas Red. I'm leaving. Texas Red is over. He's dead.
It's probably like Salinger, great American writer. In fact, a very interesting thing about American writer, mm-hmm. that they often, best ones, give it up. Or pretend to one or the other.
Who's the poet you were talking about?
Pinch and pretend. Oh, Alvin Fineman really
Alvin
gave
Fineman.
It up.
Alvin Fineman, yes, yeah. Of course.
Sanger did not really give it up. He gave up punk.
Well, he gave it up, but did you know that he was working for the CIA?
This is not surprising.
I mean, he had a mini...
Turtle not against CIA.
No, I think you've been working for the CIA too. I'm almost certain Tony had been working for the British.
It's very possible. Because once you work for example, MI6, they often send you to Africa and you pretend to your friends that you're just going to Africa.
at the British Museum. Well, young man, of the 21 Chinese pieces you wished appraised, 20 are attractive country works of peripheral interest. On the other hand, this shattered Ming demon dog vase would be worth in excess of £2 million if intact. I've seen one other example in my 30-year career. Its actual restored value I would place at about £5,000. And anticipating your question, to get it professionally done in Great Britain would easily cost $8,000.
Nothing like the road, hey Tony? I tell you, we've put in it a lot of miles, a lot of experience. It's all based on the will. I'm telling you, it's exciting. It's every day is more exciting than the previous day. Let the will manifest itself. Let it go. Let it run. Are you still sleeping? You are sleeping. Oh well, you know.
What's going on? You're scaring me a little. You seem a little frantic, a little crazy, honestly.
I'm sorry.
No, it's fine. I can't help you if you don't tell me what's going on. You're being very cryptic in a really bizarre way.
There is a whole world in my life that you don't know.
Can you share with me?
There is this crazy guy, Texas Red.
Okay, who is this Texas Red?
It's a friend of mine. He goes back a long time ago. I can't get into details, but
you can never get into the details. I don't know anything about your
because
past.
It's like I want you to know that this friend of mine, Texas Red, knows a lot of things about dangerous things, big things. And according to him, and I know that for a fact, he's gone.
Like, no.
There are ways that you can be gone.
Okay, he's dead?
No.
He went to another country?
No, he went to another planet. Okay. Well, the more, I know, you see, the more I tell you, the less you believe me.
What?
That's the problem.
I mean, like...
It's like, the more I tell you, the more you will say...
How am I supposed to react? This seems crazy. What do you mean he's in another planet? Is he an astronaut? He's traveling the galaxy?
Well, Texas Red is gone, and what he's saying is that we should go too.
We're to join the space cowboy?
He's asking you.
Hey, where are we going to go, Mother? What planet have we picked to live on?
Escape to an island of earthly delights. A rose is a rose is a rose. My name is Carlos now.
I know that you've been working for the CIA for a long time, but is this turtle disguise something that you just have collapsed into to...
If you think the turtle's so stupid as to work for CIA and admit it on camera, you have another thing coming.
Camera? Sir John, there's no camera. We're just talking. I came to say goodbye, that's all. I mean, we haven't seen each other for a long time. And so you haven't seen Tony anymore?
No, he disappeared in Africa, part of darkness.
The Kensington Gardens. Athenapolis against the apparatus, says Tony, walking a breezy June afternoon through the Kensington Gardens.
Athenapolis against the apparatus. It's the best way to value the modern world. Athenapolis is a branch of individualistic Western culture, rooted in Athens and the Florentine Renaissance. One idea, one experience, one reality informs conscious society. The individual becomes the singularity by enabling the singularity of others. It starts by guiding our children and extends to every citizen of the city. Everyone masters the sciences of mind. Everyone masters the art of body. To inspire the singularity of future generations. In semi-conscious society, the individual is a statistical location of the herd. From the Harvard professor to the McDonald's line cook, each location is a paranoid specialist programmed for obedience. Fear of losing herd protection and utter ignorance. The apparatus is a virus from the East, conquering the aristocratic West with alien perception. Alien emotions, alien thought forms. The first Abrahamic rule of society was correct vengeance, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. So the law of the apparatus became an eye for a tooth. The second Abrahamic rule of society was love the other as you love yourself. So the law of the apparatus became hate the other as you hate yourself. These falsified Eastern rules became the big lie of the apparatus, the propaganda, the babble of semi-conscious media. Every newspaper and magazine, every radio program, every film and TV show justifies it. In Athenapolis, the individual becomes conscious in the free course of human events, like a wave arises on the shore, or the wind bends the sequoias. When the law makes perversions into institutions administered without check or balance by the executive of execution, when the law attacks the noble tree of individualistic Western culture, the course is no longer free. The individual becomes an outsider, a terrorist, a monster and more, in defense of personal liberty. It's not about falsified vengeance. It's not about falsified love. It's about singularity and community. Athenapolis against the apparatus. It's the best way to value all modern philosophy.
Well, says Frank, as they find an empty bench.
Well, you have the utopian zeal of a confirmed misanthrope. How do you think singularity theory can overcome semi-conscious control? Where is this Athenapolis? Hidden in the Greek islands, floating somewhere in cyberspace? How can you assume that the international banking octopus and its nation-state satraps will allow you to survive your idea. Could Athenapolis simply be the name of your contempt for semi-conscious man?
Of course, says Tony.
Of course.
As they rise and resume walking.
Without an understanding of the three wills, life is a recurring dream dreamt by somebody else. Nietzsche called him the last man, because he lived for his latest comfort. The apparatus richly rewards slaves entertaining slaves, slaves killing slaves. It excites the sheep to act like wolves. It excites the lemmings to act like jackals. It excites components to unplug their competition. It exalts all the degenerate passions. Yes. We must be discreet in our discourse. But we must also be bold. Athenapolis will survive the apocalypse in strategic chrysalis. Its first phase is a holding company of intellectual rights, where writers, artists, inventors, and other creatives contribute their royalties and patents to color the city's economic needs. In the second phase, emissaries of Athenapolis serve as peacemakers for decaying nation states at war. When we accept territory in exchange for saving the world from military hegemonies. In the third phase, we secure energy independence when our engineers install solar-powered islands, producing electricity, fresh water, hydrogen for our developing city. In the fourth phase, our scientists deploy advanced defense systems, reverse engineered in Siberia and Nevada, making Athenapolis impervious to the nuclear, biological, conventional military attacks of the collapsing apparatus. In its fifth phase, Athenapolis stimulates the birth of 1,000 beautiful new cities, and we achieve new renaissance. Were not when Stanley, content to raise pigs on St. George's Hill, we demand the fall of the apparatus. We demand the earth in its unfolding mystery. Athenapolis is the quantum city that remains small as it expands into infinity from a handful of astonishing ideas. It's absurd. That's why it's great. Yes, maybe you'll have to travel more, suffer more, to understand these contradictions, Frank. Oedipus was in exile until he solved the riddle. Oedipus was in exile until he understood his way. Oedipus is Odysseus, Frank. Everything outside is inside. The Mediterranean Sea is the theory enveloping your brain. For all its humor and adventure, your journey of self-knowledge is a tragedy, and the peaceful illumination of semi-conscious society is a technical impossibility. That's why we fight, why we demand a conscious society. We start small and we stay small, self-sufficient, self-defined. We never exceed the measure of Mars. We never repeat the cancer of the nation state or the corruption of the global corporation. We start small and we become universal. Aristotle refused to follow Socrates. He mastered his love and hate of the state. He went beyond exile. He transformed his will to consciousness into world history. Through Alexander, he brought justice to decadent Athens. Through Alexander, he introduced philosophy to the disconnected barbarian myth. Through Alexander, he took a queen for each season of the day. Through Alexander, the world became Aristotelian. Such magnificent intent. When the apparatus falls, we'll need this accelerating intelligence, this natural will to power. Because the second problem of philosophy is projecting projectors. Every singularity imagines the world, imagining him, imagines a cosmic wife loving him. But while he's building the house, she stabs him in the back. She calls a lawyer. His hammer suddenly sounds hollow. She wants it all now. She wants what the other wives have. She wants a semi-conscious man. All conditioning is projection. All projection is conditioning. The semi-conscious man is a hanging judge in a court of hypocrisy. He convicts others of his own diseases. He convicts others of his own atrocities and substitutes their deaths. For each dying cell in his body, the semi-conscious man is a concentration camp, dressed as an amusement park. The semi-conscious man is an executioner in a sharp business suit. And there's no finer semi-conscious man than a semi-conscious woman. She's the trustee. She's the informer. She's the survivor who owes her equal place in semi-conscious society to the cynical political genius of the apparatus. At the first sign of turbulence, she goes for the throat, the cash, the legal judgment. This is free market democracy. She's liberated from her father, from her husband, from her lover. She can work 3 jobs and give her babies to Moloch. The semi-conscious woman is the backbone of fascism. Let her go! Her conformism destroys her husband, her virtue, and finally, herself. Her babies are psychologically crippled orphans, eschewed to the nation-state, claimed as grease and fertilizer by the apparatus. You can thank the ancient instinct that enabled you to leave Aaron, that whispered to her, we are at war. Consider, the individual becomes a singularity by enabling the singularity of others. Athenapolis against the apparatus. It's absurd. That's why it's great. It defeats the statistics of probability. It's impossible. That's why the semi-conscious woman is the only road to Athenapolis. That's why time is the place where 3 roads meet. The semi-conscious woman is the future. See her become conscious, like a wave arriving on the shore of her body. See her become conscious, like the wind bending sequoia in her mind.
Sleeping? Oh, you are sleeping. Oh, well, you know, it's truly amazing. I mean, the beauties of thought and the complex manifestations of will are truly, truly amazing. I'm astounded. I am happy and astounded. I guess that's what the Greeks called the sense of wonder. That's where we are, Tony. You and me, on the road again.
Hey, where are we gonna go, Mother? What planet have we picked to live on?
I know. It sounds.
I want to believe you.
I just to give you all
I know is that there's this mysterious Texas red. The world's gonna end mysteriously, and we need to move to another planet. Like, okay, it does sound a little ridiculous. You seem really upset about it. You seem to believe it. I want to believe you, but like, come on, Mom. Like, I need a little bit more information. You know,
I love you. I believe you, but I just.
The cat is her, man. That's the deal. I hate the world.
Gigi.
Oh, Gigi.
Ruler of the house.
Why I'm feeding you?
Gigi's gonna die soon anyway. He's the luckiest of all
of us. Just to give me
a
few days. Just to give me a few days and start to think about that maybe there are other things out there that you don't know. And they may seem very strange. And you're gonna have to decide if you really trust what they tell you. Would you come to another planet with me?
Yeah, that's what it
is. Even if he was made out of bubblegum?
You love bubblegum. I would love to live on a bubblegum planet with you. As long as there's a cheese planet nearby that I can visit.
Well, there might well be a cheese planet. It's I'm very worried. I'm sorry. I know I can't explain to you this thing, but I'm terribly worried. I hope that it isn't true.
Yeah,
and now, please go on your way. Go make a suitcase or something, just to go do something. And I'll get in touch with you.
Somewhere near a river, can't quite tell where I am. I was blindfolded, no sign of extraction. I'm gonna have to go Jackal.
That's Spinoza.
That's a fondle Spinoza.
I did Spinoza.
How did you get Can you explain how Nietzsche relate to Spinoza, please?
Of course. Spinoza was the first Western philosopher to understand that God is the body of the universe, that one is greater or equal to two. And of course, he was a lens grinder, so these are, you know, glass shavings.
He also not believe in free will.
Like every normal person.
So how does relate to a theory of three wills? Three and three wills.
No free will.
Only three wills.
Three wills, no three wills.
No free will, only three wills is a kind of Freudian slip.
That's it. It's a mock turtle ritual.
It's a mock turtle idea. Oh, no free will, only three wills.
But you see,
if you have a list, it all work.
Yes, well, you see how the glass shards, because he was a lens grinder, the glass shards eventually got into his stomach and killed him. And that's all there. I mean, if you didn't know, you wouldn't know. But Spinoza is so...
He's a very beautiful man.
Beautiful man, very honorable man, and excommunicated, like every honorable man, truth is true.
And believe morality, unlike Texas Red, is mathematical Euclid kind of thing.
Well, I mean, he expressed himself in geometry of the day, let's say.
Huh.
But his brilliance transcends time. I mean, he had the courage to say...
He believed goodness is power.
Yes. And he believed that God is the will.
How do you not say that?
That's what I believed. I said that.
Not free will, not free
no.
will.
Determined.
Determined.
Duty, if you will. If you three will.
Strange idea.
Strange idea. But let me ask you this. I'm sure I didn't give you this painting. So how did you come by?
A turtle have training.
You mean this is a fake? You copied Texas Red?
I will not stoop to copying Texas Red.
Are you sure?